Perfect Match Podcast.
Welcome. I want to start.
Oh. Go. What?
All right. I'm just going to get right into it. I have no business off the top. Nothing like that. Coming off the matchup, we had three beats. But in that matchup, Jenna reveals, like, low-key, that Kai said he loved her at the Under the Sea party.
Not a shocker.
That it happened, not a shocker. That Jenna mentions it in front of everybody.
Okay.
Shocker. Jasmine's reaction was not my favorite thing. It was very sad. She was just like, I mean, still her strong self. But do you not remember it?
No, I don't.
She's talking to maybe Noor.
I thought she was talking to the camera.
The background is her talking to the camera. But I think she's talking to Noor. And they're bonding over just like how fucked up it is for Kai to do that.
And
after the intervention, but wait, Kai, that's what I wanted to say. Did Kai tell Jenna that before or after they kind of had their own intervention? That was after Under the Sea, right?
Yes, that was.
So
yeah.
I was wondering what went wrong there. Why Jasmine had her feelings hurt after the matchup, after everything that went down. And I realize now it's because there was no need for Jenna to say that at the matchup. Kai had already kind of came to Jesus, came to Besit.
It was kind of funny to, maybe not funny, immediately into this episode, Kai goes like, said something to the camera. I really feel like I'm turning a new leaf in my time in this house. It had been like what seemed like in airtime 15 minutes from when he was like totally causing a ruckus, basically.
Who, you know what I mean? Jonathan?
Kai.
Oh my god, yeah.
Kai saying, I've turned into a leaf. I was like, wait, what? You just found out that you're like ruining three girls' experiences here.
Right. Well, that's the first step.
Yeah, I know. It was just like,
is to just say it so that it feels
so that it
like
can happen.
It, yeah. Once you, oh gosh, poor
guy. I do have to, and maybe it's just they have a good like friendship, or but Danny and Kai, their dynamic is interesting to me.
Danny has everything to do with that, and Kai, in my opinion, has nothing to do with it. But that's just my opinion.
Oh, in terms of Danny just kind of
being
into
awesome and patient, which is kind of what Kai said. But Kai just tries to make out with everybody and be sexual with everybody and be in love with everybody. And I feel like Danny has seen through it to the point where when he was like trying to like kiss him on the neck when they were cuddling.
Yeah.
Whatever. It was just like, Kai, you haven't turned a new leaf. Look at you.
Yeah, and it's, I feel like it's also Danny
being awesome.
Giving, this is just me. I would never, if Kai was doing that the whole time. I'm surprised that Danny's still giving an attempt at the Kai.
Well, Danny also thinks they're a match, potentially. They are still potentially a match.
Yeah.
That's probably why he's still giving them the time. Think about it. Maybe not, but
it's just, yeah, I guess that probably plays into it somewhat. Reading the tea leaves or whatever in terms of trying to explain why you would be a match, or trying to find out the reason why you would be a match with this person. That's why you'd keep giving them more chances and saying things like, I really care about Kai. And
also wanting to win the money and saying,
yeah,
hey, it's not unlikely that I am Kai's match. So I should be talking to Kai because Kai shouldn't be talking to anyone else. And I'm going to talk to Kai as many times as I can talk to Kai.
Okay.
Like, I feel like that might be another level.
That actually makes a lot of sense. If that's the reason, then that makes so much sense. Kai's causing a lot of destruction. Mm-hmm. Let me reel him back in because he's my match. Then I can cause...
It's almost my responsibility to reel him in and at least talk to him.
Yeah.
And of course, Kai's like, oh, let me kiss your neck. It's like, all right. I just am not a big Kai fan. I think everyone's
fatigue. I think it's Kai fatigue.
Mm-hmm. It's weird, though, because normally... I don't know. This doesn't have anything to do with anything, but Kai somehow gets like more attractive. Like I can see where people are coming from.
Oh.
I feel like I've said that since the beginning. Maybe I just think Kai's kind of hot.
Yeah, you said I think week one.
I did, but I said everyone was, and some of them I was lying. Molly called me out in a text.
What?
No, I'm not going to say it, but she'll know what I'm talking about. And I'm just going to, I'm going to be honest from now on. No more lies.
I want to hear it afterwards. Anyways, moving on. Amber Justin. Amber kind of pulls Justin aside for this conversation and apologizing for being a temptation or causing a temptation between him and Max. Justin, in very... non-Justin-like ways, is pretty, I feel like, pretty confident in what he's saying and just squashes it.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, the feeling was mutual. I'm also not going to mess with Max. So I kind of towed the line and this is a friendship and that was it.
Here's what do you want to hear? That's a great assessment. I went a little bit harder on Amber.
Mm-hmm.
Although Amber and Max have been posting a bunch with each other lately, which is strange. Not strange. Interesting.
It makes me, makes the eyebrows raise a little bit.
Right. Interesting. But Amber's apology was round two of temptation masked in an apology. She's sitting there like,
yep,
you know, in that case, Amber, if you are sorry, stay the hell away from Justin. That's your apology. Don't go up to him. Be a one-on-one conversation.
Laying down.
Giving him those eyes.
Yep. I know. It should be a standing... that conversation should take place standing up. Vertical. Vertical conversation. And arm's length away.
Instead of thinking... like, Amber's apology equals, I'm not sorry. Here's how you know, because I'm doing it again right now.
Oh my God.
Oh, Amber.
I'm just so sorry that I was such a temptation and like we wanted to fuck and like.
Right.
I was trying
to push you past that line.
And like
line.
I was like leading you towards my cleavage.
You guys can't see, but Reggie's trying
cupping
to
my breasts.
Ew. Not you.
Justin?
No, Amber.
Oh.
Was like, couldn't get him in a mermaid suit. Maybe I'll try cute casual and reel him in.
I can't wait for apology round three next week.
Oh my gosh. She's going to apologize to Max.
What will
and
the
then
outfit
they're
be?
Gonna follow. Hence the pictures.
What are we thinking for the outfit for apology three?
Business
like
cash.
Sexy schoolgirl. Yeah. Schoolgirl.
Okay, I think we both met somewhere. In
yeah,
the
yeah. Okay. Yeah, we're in the right. We're in the ballpark.
Yours was more like the
stereotypical
straight dude way of saying what I was saying.
Yeah.
Business casual, sexy schoolgirl. that's too funny.
Oh my God.
Okay, where are we going?
Well,
Raige, Paige,
Raige,
and Remy.
Paige, Raige.
So, we've learned a little bit about Paige's past, and, like, I think we all want to at least glimpse this motherfucker who told her not to have feelings.
Yeah.
Get the fuck out of here.
Also, the
way she phrased it was interesting to me. Sorry, I want to say just this, and then you respond. Over and over again, she phrased it as, he made me feel unattractive. He made my emotions feel unattractive. Like, that is deep and dark manipulation. Like, not to say it's bothering me that you are feeling this way. It's annoying me. But, like, you look ugly when you cry, is what I picture that this dude said to Paige. I know that she never said that. Mm-hmm. But do you see what I'm saying?
Stuff like that, yes.
It was, yeah, not just like, oh, he told me I was weak. She did say that. He told me I was weak for having emotions, which that's one thing. And like, that's one way someone could make someone feel that way. I'm using mm-hmm. a lot of pronouns here.
Yeah. No. But I agree.
The way that Paige phrased it was so specific almost, where she was like, I used to be more open and emotional, and then someone made me feel unattractive for being that way. And like, dude, everyone looks ugly when they cry. I bet Paige looks hot as shit when she's angry. So that dude is an asshole. Isn't that weird how people look ugly when they cry usually? I mean, that's such a mean thing to say, but just, you know, that you don't want a picture of you crying, but like an angry face is a good picture.
That is pretty funny.
We are fucked up species.
This is kind of, I didn't expect to think this or go down this thought trail. You just said, I think we all want to glimpse this motherfucker. Mm-hmm. And I'm just thinking about, you know, Paige is, I think, the youngest person on the show. I think she's 21. Mm-hmm. She said multiple times that it was a relationship when she was 18, which makes you think it also drifted past that into like 17, basically a high school relationship.
Oh, I don't think that this was a statutory.
No. I was. Oh my God, I was not okay. going in that regard. I was just saying it was. It seems like it was a high school, a relationship between two people transitioning high school to college, maybe even before that. I'm just saying, like, I think that, you know, she's now 3 years removed from that, reflecting on what this guy had kind of maybe manipulated her or was very, just extremely possessive and didn't want, like,
degrading, it and seems.
Stuff like that. I just, you know, be, you know, formerly a 17 or 18 year old, I just feel like I look back on some of the things that I either said to girls or like alluded to girls and not really realizing how that was affecting the other person.
Yeah.
And I just remember hear like stuff that my friends would talk about, like with their girlfriends or with like, it's pretty fucked up.
It's a culture.
It is a culture.
And like, you're not even a bad dude at all. Like, you wouldn't straight up. Well, maybe you are.
I don't think nothing I said was malicious. And nothing I said, but it was so unaware. And stuff, you know, little things too that I think back. I don't want to get specific.
I want you to get specific.
I'll tell you after, maybe.
Why? But whoever is probably isn't listening, and you owe it to them.
No, just like things about, like, kind of what you were saying, like appearance and.
You've told a girl she's an ugly crier.
I've never said that.
Thank you.
But, and just like kind of off.
Just confess? What did you say?
I don't want to say. Cause
it's that bad.
No, it's not that bad. It's just embarrassing stuff. I'll give like a broad example of like comparing, not realizing that I was comparing like a girl to another girl in terms of like their looks. Saying around other girls or my girlfriend or something,
that someone else was hot.
That girl's so hot or something.
You didn't realize that that's something you shouldn't say?
I mean, I was probably drunk when I said that thing. And also just, I mean, I'm just, this is the stuff that looking back on it, God, even I looked back on that like 2 years later probably and was like, what the fuck was I doing? But it's stuff like that.
Wow.
Not to take the side of Paige's boyfriend or ex-boyfriend. Definitely not trying to do that.
Oh, but he was much older, we decided. I'm kidding. I thought that's where you were going because you said high school. But no offense, but not knowing is not really an excuse. Like,
no, definitely
not. If you're going to be like around women, you have a responsibility to like be thinking about things. And I'm not trying to
no.
shit on you. That's like, I feel, and I'm I feel for you, but I also,
but it's also like, it's the culture and stuff.
I also am mad at just the whole idea of that, and thinking about it, it makes me mad, and I don't feel that bad for you. I'm sorry.
You really shouldn't. Guess but what? You were just fucking fine.
You were just very vulnerable, so I want to just like pat. Also, fuck you, 17-year-old Reggie, for making whoever feel insecure by parading your stupid-ass thoughts. I'm sure she thought guys were hot, too, but the society doesn't really care.
No.
Because, I mean, look at some celebrities. Seth Rogen stars in films.
And he's really hot.
And he's a heartthrob. That was mean. He's not even like, I see, that's the thing. I don't even think anyone's ugly. Wait, either way.
To quick aside to get off this topic, maybe.
Please.
Seth Rogen, his episode of Jerry Seinfeld, the comedians in cars.
Yeah.
I can't really watch that show anymore without just thinking Jerry Seinfeld probably thinks he's funnier than all these people. And that one in particular, if you watch it, and maybe I'm going to ruin it for people who are going to watch it. It is such a, like...
Okay, I don't know if I can say this on our podcast.
What?
And this is me being super extreme, okay? Super, super, super extreme.
Say it.
Because
hot
it's
take.
A, it's a
hot take.
It's not a hot take. It's a very controversial statement. But watching that show, I was... I want to say again. I know I'm prefacing this too much. I don't care. I want to say again, like... I know. I was aware even as I was going through this mind trip. Like, Jerry Seinfeld, at his core, like, the definition of racist, he probably is. Like, and all the things. Like, he's just so... Like, and no, that is not funny at all. And, like, there's no harmless racism. I think he thinks he's better
than everyone.
And like, no problem. See, that's what I'm saying. Like, I know, I knew in my head that he wasn't. I was like, I know he's not. Well, like, that's a crazy thing to say. That's a crazy accusation. But what led me there was not that crazy. That's what I'll say.
And I do think there is some truth to, the Venn diagram of people who think they're better than everyone and people who are racist, I think there's a good amount of overlap there.
Yeah, there's probably that's one of those rare Venn diagrams where the outside is actually a very the sliver.
Yeah.
You have trouble writing in there in school. Which is a Jerry Seinfeld type joke.
Yes. Oh my god.
Like, I'm not, you know, I'm just not the biggest fan of that show. And I will not go on record to say that that Jerry Seinfeld is a racist.
Except you did.
I'm saying I retract. I just think he is so comfortable being a straight white male that that is exactly the leap I took.
Okay.
And I see how far it is. I know I'm not getting there, but yeah. I just...
That same level of comfortableness you've seen in... Very racist man.
Well, I just think...
And he also has that same level of
I think it's false logic, but you could see someone making that connection. Like, oh, someone's so comfortable and happy, stuck in his old straight white male ways. How could he possibly not be for white power over black power? Like, that is too it's false logic. Is a leap.
I got
you. Or there's, you know, it's in the distance.
I don't think Jerry would vibe well with this season of Are You the One.
Oh my god, he would. He wouldn't vibe well with anything.
He would shrivel up.
He would see just, he wouldn't vibe well with the straight seasons of Are You the One. What are they putting their hands down? Like, that man,
what is this?
Wants a horse matches and carriage. He's so old school. It's annoying. That's really my problem with him. And it comes off as
he's just living in 1992.
Memes about baby boomers.
Jerry Seinfeld.
That's him in a nutshell.
Pretty much, yeah.
It's like, Yeah, maybe I don't know how to screw in a... Or maybe I don't know how to fix a shelf, hang a shelf. Mm-hmm. But at least I can tell my daughter I love her. Like, oh my God. It's like such a hard hitting right there. And I feel like that's Jerry. Like,
yeah.
He was just... The episode of him with Ellen, that was the one where I was just like, oh, he just doesn't give a fuck what anyone else is about. He just is gonna just
on his own prerogative.
He's gonna roll his eyes cool in cars. Front of someone that clearly is not trying to make a joke. I mean, whatever.
Yeah, yeah. It's uncomfortable mm-hmm. at times. But I'm gonna watch it tonight. Gonna watch it tonight because wow. I want to feel uncomfortable as I'm falling asleep. That's the point.
Didn't you feel uncomfortable admitting that you emotionally abused?
I've already felt very uncomfortable this whole night. That's what this episode's about. Reggie feels uncomfortable. Name of the episode.
Don't worry, we're going to title it so you aren't listening if you didn't know this was coming. Okay, let's actually talk about the show.
The challenge.
The challenge. You loved it so much.
Loved it. IKEA furniture, building it. There's not a better, there is not a more, you cannot bond more as a couple than building IKEA furniture.
You know what I liked about it? The setup of the challenge was that they didn't require, there wasn't like some sort of gimmicky barrier or like, it was just one person is holding the directions and you cannot physically switch.
Yep. Yeah.
But you can stand there and point to things. It's funnier.
Yep.
And yeah, it's
there
better,
wasn't like a blindfold. I get what you're saying.
Or like behind a curtain. Mm-hmm. It was just, this is what you would look like in your living room. Like if there was one stipulation, you cannot switch because you always switch and then you're like, okay, as long as if I can work with it and read it. It's yep. like any education.
I also think
you've got to be able to see it written down and then also do it manipulating mm-hmm. it with your hands and then you learn it. But this was great.
I just think it's perfect because everyone that has built IKEA furniture with a significant other, there's a couple things about it. One is you always, when you finish it, you give each other a high five and you think, wow, we're awesome at this.
Yep.
Even if you're building it by yourself, you think the same thing.
Oh.
Wow, I crushed that. I'm so good at it.
I'm a carpenter. I'm a craftsman.
Yeah. You immediately reaction. You could, regardless of how fast or slow you do it, that is what your thought process mm-hmm. is at the end. My second thing is, just like this challenge, for some reason when you're building IKEA furniture, that is the only mission. Everything else, nothing else matters. Time stops and it is... All right, we have 25 steps. We are getting through all these before I even drink another sip of water. I will not go pee. I will not step outside. Nothing will happen.
You may have just figured something out that's like really groundbreaking.
Groundbreaking. I just think it's I think it's actually true.
Well, I would love to do a study with school children. Have something similar. And mm-hmm. see if it's the same thing, because that is the goal. That's the goal, always, in everything, is to have time stop, you're lost in what you're doing,
yeah.
because you're so focused on what is actually happening in yeah. front of you. That's the goal. IKEA has unlocked.
They have.
The
In the also, 21st century, with social media and how addicted we are to our phones, that is like the one guaranteed thing. Two guaranteed things. There are two guaranteed things that I will not look at my phone during. One, building IKEA furniture. Two is as a guy peeing in a urinal, and if there is a sign in front of me, whatever it is, I will read what is on that sign.
Okay.
Showering? Okay, showering. But that's different. Being in a pool, that's also...
Watching your four-year-old daughter?
Not the case.
Wow.
Wish it was the case. Not the case.
We're gonna need
but
to
I'm man enough to
that.
Admit that.
I mean, you're admitting a lot of things. I don't know if any of them are good. Oh, man. Yeah.
But I loved this challenge.
IKEA. That
also...
is... Okay, here's what I want to say about this challenge. Okay.
I have conspiracy.
You No, there's no conspiracy for me. Do you have one?
I have one, but you go first.
Okay, I don't want to forget mine, but I don't think I will. I want to hear your conspiracy first.
Okay, conspiracy, I think it was a... We kind of got a glimpse of them rigging it. How? Not the producers, the cast.
The cast should rig it. That was my point.
Oh, they absolutely should rig it.
They should rig it every time. My point was, why did Noor and Danny win? We're not actually trying to build IKEA furniture fastest here. Have the one screw and be shoving it in whoever you want to win's face. Don't actually finish Justin and Max should be in there. There should be no Noor and Danny.
I have a theory on all of this.
All right.
Can I lay it out here?
Please.
I think they sat together, and this is something they didn't show, but they alluded to it, and I'll get to that. I think they sat down. They said, okay, guys, let's send Paige and Remy. We think they might be a match. Let's send them into the truth booth this week. We're pretty certain about Jonathan and Basit. Max and Justin will get to you next week. But Paige and Remy, we're going to send you in this week. I think that's what they decided.
Okay.
And then in fairness to everyone wants to go on these dates. You get to go on a helicopter.
True.
You get to, you know, eat probably a nice meal compared to like the cafeteria food that's in the house. So let's, okay, then everyone else, you can go, you can try as hard as you can. But make sure that Paige and Remy get in the pairing.
Still stupid. You only have a couple weeks left, and you only have one perfect match. Just have all three locked in.
No, but, I know, but okay. I think you should let okay, we're going to send Paige and Remy in regardless. Let's give everyone else an even chance on going on this date.
How about have one open slot and give Max and Justin a freebie?
No.
They weren't even partnered up. Oh, that was another thing.
They weren't partnered up. So they probably looked at the partners and was like, Paige and Remy, you're the one that makes the most sense.
They all
sense.
Just kind of went,
shrug. Everyone else go balls to the walls, but once two people are in, stop. Stop and let Paige and Remy win. And I think we got a glimpse of them doing that when, like, Justin and whoever he was with, Basit.
Rip the back
Justin
off.
And Basit, yeah, were kind of, like, messing with it. I don't know. And Remy's, wait. But not trying to make it super obvious. Wink, wink. Stop. Yes. Break your thing. Ours is done. He's going to come over here.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. I think that's what kind of happened.
I wish I saw that more because that was my problem. I cracked
the code.
Thank God you saw that because I...
You were getting
was annoyed. At I was annoyed.
Else. And I bet a lot of people watching.
When anytime Noor does anything, I get annoyed. But when she's like celebrating, I'm like, you're standing next to Danny. Why the fuck are you going on a date? Why are you in the truth booth realm? But then again, no, you should have three viable matches. That way, someone who's not going to be outspoken can still vote for who they think might be a perfect match. You know what I mean? Like, it still would have some sort of, like, survivor aspect where it's a secret.
Yeah, but I also... I understand what you're getting at. But I also think that you should... If just to eliminate the chance that people are going to vote for some outsider, I mean, just get an obvious one in there. I didn't write down what the other pairings were, but like, were there even any that you remember that could have been even close to matches? I'd be interested in looking back on, you know, after week 10, see what the perfect matches were, see what the pairings were for this challenge and for others, and see like,
but they have control over their pairing, so why not?
They don't have control. Production had control over this one.
Oh, it did.
I mean, if they had control, you don't think Max and Justin would have been partners?
I thought that they only had the two, the worst and the best.
No, it went in the middle. So it was the worst and the best, and the second worst, second best.
Really?
Yeah.
And mm-hmm. Paige and Remy somehow were matched up?
Yes.
So then all of what we're talking about is nonsense.
Not
doesn't
nonsense.
Matter. Well, they... If it was one different and they didn't match up.
They probably would have picked a different couple to be the chosen one. And then that other couple would have been, wait. And the whole thing would have happened.
I'm not down.
Rand, come on.
I'm not down. It's like when it's always comes back to when Cassandra won the challenge. And then realizes it was whoever. And then she's crying around. And she's like, you won.
It was Ryan. It was Ryan that he was the host.
Oh, Ryan. I was just thinking, yeah.
Yeah, it was like, it wasn't Terrence. It was like Jalen's eye instead of...
I think
of,
it was Mike, and they had already been a no match. Oh, it was confirmed Mike's... no match.
It was Mike's eye instead of Joey, or Joey's eye instead of... I forget what it was. And that it was like, so
literally all they had crying. To do was tilt you won the eyes date. Up. They couldn't see. They genuinely couldn't. The view was skewed because it was a zoomed in eyeball, and it was eye level.
Talk about rigged...
Everything's season. Rigged.
I know everything's rigged. But, like, comparing and contrasting, the production is doing whatever they can to make season 8 win. And they were doing whatever they could to get season 5 to lose.
You're right. They're learning. I mean, they probably, somewhere in the fine print, it says, like...
Production?
In the thing they signed. It's like, we're trying to find the best, the optimum... difficulty level.
Yeah.
So you're going to have to deal with some...
Well, and this one was different. I mean, with the you could be matched with anyone, it's different.
Oh, yeah. I mean, but they're starting a whole new hiccup.
Yeah. But, I mean, it's
hiccup
just,
road.
It's just...
They're going to figure things out.
Crazy thing. It's all right. To season 5.
It's funny.
So, okay, Paige and Remy win. They go on the date.
They all do. They also split up. 3 and 3, even though there's 3 couples.
I didn't even notice that.
I know, I noticed it. I was like, well, yeah, it's all rigged.
It's probably like Danny and Nora just like, I mean, you know, we don't really give a fuck.
Bissett was asked to leave the other day. He won, yeah. So
yeah,
they won.
That doesn't surprise.
So, doesn't surprise any of us.
Paige mentions it starts raining while Remy's being very vulnerable towards her. And she goes, oh, it's a golden shower.
And Remy... Listen, here's now that we know they're no match, mm-hmm. I have to say that for Remy to bite his tongue, whatever one-liner that was there, is not the best. It's not your best self, Remy. Whatever you were thinking when Paige said it's a golden shower should have been said.
I don't know what the joke is. Something like, just like our president.
It's a funny little, like... I think that Remy veers on the friend that it's hard for them to say something nice, maybe. Like, because their could be, love yeah. language is, like, being sarcastic and, like, giving little, like, joking jabs.
Yeah.
That's just what he strikes me as. But with Paige, I think that he doesn't want to do that because she's so sweet and innocent. And so...
You know
it's
what I just thought
not
of?
Not necessarily myself, yes. What?
Remy already mentioned golden showers earlier this season. First episode.
Wait.
I forgot about that. Coming, firing out of the gate. I forget who he was talking to.
He probably had so much to say.
I forgot who he was talking to, but... Do you like a little pee play? Didn't he say something like that?
Water sports?
Water sports.
No, I don't know if
you
he said
that. But he definitely mentioned little pee play. So the golden shower, maybe that was a reference. Maybe that's why they cut that all out, because it was just a callback to episode 1. Little pee play, little golden shower. Either way, so funny.
I mean, Paige is adorable. It's a sun shower.
It's a sun shower.
Was that like an opera version of...
It's a sun shower.
Spider-Man?
Yeah.
That was so cute.
Mm-hmm.
Also, but I do wish that I could hear what Remy's joke yeah. was, because it was
show
probably,
us the footage.
And
footage.
I'm sure Paige would have appreciated knowing that it's not called the golden shower, and don't say that in a romantic, vulnerable moment, because that's when you pee on someone for erotic purposes.
But for Remy, maybe that would have been appropriate. So
no, he had to bite
so
his
works.
Tongue.
It works.
In their rom-com, that is like a whole scene.
Oh.
Where she keeps saying golden shower, and like, you know this character as Remy in the background, and he's just like, oh, and like.
And maybe he even has like a mic on him so people can feed him lines, and everyone, like his buddies are listening and can hear her say golden shower.
And he's an impractical joker. So that's part of the plot. He's actually playing Q.
Yes, exactly.
Make
now
that
we're
rom-com.
On to something.
Make that rom-com.
The impractical joker's rom-com. That's what we need.
That,
what,
that,
what the
that
fuck
is
are we doing
we
with
need.
This podcast? Let's go fucking make that.
I'm going to DM Q really quick.
I'm going to start writing. I'll start writing the script.
Actually, James Murray is the one we should DM. How about the fact that one of the Impractical Jokers has the exact same name as Jimmy from this podcast?
Love
it all. This is such a quick aside. This entire thing has been an aside. Which is a shame because this whole episode is great. The actual show.
Oh, it's fine.
What
are you going to say?
I want to just at least have Jimmy over or in some way watch...
The challenge premiere?
The challenge premiere with him, even if it's not the night of. And pod for that, and then no commitments after that.
Just talk about the premiere?
Mm-hmm.
I know. I got to say... And I do love this season of Are You the One. I would put it in my top three for sure.
Mm-hmm.
But I am a little...
You're just pod fatigued.
Pod fatigued, and it's been the challenge going into Are You the One. It was no break.
It has nothing to do with the pod itself. I had nothing going.
It's also so life fatigue.
Georgia has grown up. She's no longer a baby, and I have a job now. Like, so much has changed.
And I'm working Saturdays way more and stuff. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, it makes sense for us to take a little hiatus. But this season's going to be good. And I at least want to, I do, even if we don't pot about it, I do want to, I don't just say that on here, but yeah. I do want to watch it with Jimmy so much. Yeah. I also haven't seen Jimmy's long.
Back to the pod. Truth Booth. Rage.
Kari.
No match. Kari. Actual Rage. We got to get our heads in the game. That's what
she's
yells.
She's like screaming.
Everyone. Every season, no doubt, guarantee someone will say that.
She's like, I don't know, but that fucked me up. Dad, no match.
Fucked me up.
And then, this is nothing, but I rewound it because I was like, Reggie, look at Kai. Was just standing there being the one who should be saying nothing in the house to anyone because you have fucked this whole game up, Kai. And Kai's just like, Oh, yeah, put everybody down, Kari. Yeah, put everybody down.
Nah, didn't say it like that.
Yes, he did.
I'm pretty sure he said, you're putting everybody down, Kari.
That was the first, maybe.
Oh, he said it twice?
Yes. He may have said, you're putting everybody down, but then he was just like, put everybody down. Good idea. Like,
what a thing to say.
From that,
in the moment.
In your denim romper.
I know.
God.
How dare you?
How dare.
The gall.
Yeah, there was just... No reason for that.
The gall.
So then, thank God for Carrie's rage.
Get down to business.
To light up 8 beams.
Oh, maybe that's our next parody.
Oh my God, it is. Maybe. Shit, I haven't even thought about it.
Did they send me? Oh, I don't know.
Don't riff on the pod.
I just wanted to get
yourself into trouble.
I want to have it say something like, did they send me straight guys when I asked for gays?
Four like byes.
Okay. Sorry. Whoa.
Whoa. If anybody wants to help us with that, please send us.
We don't have time.
We just told you how busy we are. Everybody loves to hear how busy other people are.
Anyways, they get down to business.
And they confirm Basit and Jonathan, which we already knew.
Yeah. They also confirm
Nor and Jasmine. And then Nor and Jasmine.
Yeah. Oh, my God. They're
okay.
In love.
Well, remember when Nor was like, when they were fighting and Nor said... Are you mimicking me? Or because Jasmine was like, yeah, let's just talk for a second.
Uh-huh.
And she's like, oh, are you being serious? Or are you just mimicking me? And then Jasmine thought about it for a second. Was like, oh, no, I'm just mimicking you. That's actually almost a direct quote from Danny. Shouts to Danny.
Who?
Matt's boyfriend.
Oh.
A regular.
Not Danny on the show.
Oh, my God, no. Not Danny on the show.
Gotta specify.
Also, I don't even think my Danny listens.
Danny in real life.
So I was acting like that was going to be a little shout. I just felt bad because I genuinely directly quoted what he said about that scene. It was really funny, though, when it happened. And now they're a match. I think that, first of all, Noor will do whatever she can do to be able to talk like this in a situation. Like, yeah. Girl, what? That's what I want. A ranch? That's exactly what I want.
You a fuck boy. You just a fuck boy.
No, because this one, she's being like,
no, I know.
Okay. This is, yeah. Okay, that's goals. All right. Like, just, when she's talking about, when Jasmine's talking about growing up on a ranch, like, a stable girl? A stable girl? Like, anything she can do to be excited or angry, she's game. Jasmine, I think, is too good for her, but also too good for me and my judgment, because she probably knows it and doesn't know it at the same time. And it's just like, I'm enjoying this. It's fun.
Can you, you can understand this? This is a head scratcher for me. Why? The Noor and Jasmine thing.
How?
If I was a producer, if I was one of the matchmakers and I'm watching this thing play out throughout the weeks, they literally are like screaming at each other last week. Jasmine almost punches Noor.
Okay, so we've talked about this. And Sarah's told us about this. This is a callback. I feel like I know where you're going. I'm sorry to cut you off. Remember, and if I'm wrong, correct me. Remember when Sarah was talking about how men bond with each other over competing for a girl. And it becomes less about the girl, more about the competition with the other. Girls don't have that, I don't think. It's biology. Like, girls don't bond over competing. So that's the opposite of what just happened. But it's a bond and a break. It's like a feeling of like, we both are puffing up over this. We're never going to be bros, but like, we're both I more so want to make you feel like shit than I want to win this girl at this point.
The word bond is not the right word, I feel. Because when I think bond, I think
connotationless in this point. Right. In this point, bond is connotationless.
The relationship between the two guys matters more
than winning the
negative
girl.
Relationship between the two guys matters more than the positive relationship between either of the two guys and the girl.
Right. It's not a good bond.
Yeah.
Okay. And I think with girls, that is not a thing. Like, you genuinely just want that person to disappear. There's nothing you like about, you don't want to compete. You don't want any of it. I mean, some girls probably do.
And it's like, get your point across and then back to, okay, me and Kai, or back to...
No, but you also are ready to love the person. Like, you want to be buddy, but even when you're straight, I'm saying, like, when you can get attention in a friendly way with someone, like, exes of the same guy.
I was just going to say that.
Bond so much. Like, not get attention. I don't mean that. Because when you're dating a guy, you do not, you want the ex or whoever the girl is to disappear. But once it's passed or whatever, like this situation with Noor and Jasmine.
I totally
sounds amazing. If I could be attracted to someone that was the ex of someone, and I probably could at some point.
Who was the ex of your ex?
Yep. That would be awesome. And I would love them. Like, it's not the same for girls and boys. I could have just said that, so.
Well, you explained yourself. You showed your work.
Mm-hmm.
Showed your work.
I showed that I didn't really do much work.
I just think if I was a producer, I would just be like, I'm still, it kind of blows my mind. It's almost like...
If you were a male producer. Not if you're a female producer.
If I'm me and I'm a producer, right. It just blows my mind. Not that they're, like, the whole relationship with Kai. And really not... Less about them fighting. I know that I brought that up. I know that's where I started with it.
Right.
But it's really just, like, they got confirmed as a perfect match. And now they went from, at best, neutral with each other. Like... What are you talking about? Why are you shaking your head? At best, they were indifferent to each other, Jasmine and Noor.
I think
at worst they hated each other.
Oh,
before they confirmed they were a perfect match. You know, their relationship before they confirmed they were a perfect match. At best, they were indifferent to each other.
Uh-huh.
Right?
Okay. Yes. Yeah. Yep.
And then confirmed perfect match. Now they are relating on a deeper level. They're just making out, all this stuff. And I feel like it's a lot Nora trying to get camera time, that kind of stuff. And like you said, Nora trying to, any excuse to like pop off in a negative or positive way.
One way or the other.
But it just is so, I don't know. It just like, it makes me just, I can't understand it. I can't wrap my head around. You get confirmed as a perfect match over these random matchmakers that decide that the two of you have some sort of compatible thing, and then you just run with it, and now, all right, sweet, we're just gonna be a couple. Not really, but it seems like it.
But think about it, too.
I just don't think we've seen anything like this before.
True. I mean, I can wrap my head around it, and I'm here for it. I love it.
Blows my mind.
Think about it, too, though. It's a group of 16 people in one house for this long. That's not that many people, and both of them are Nora's not that reasonable, but she's attention craving. Jasmine's reasonable, and Nora can be funny, and she's probably like, when she calms down sometimes, is fine. You know, like we're seeing obviously edited shit. People like her. Bassett likes her. So I will take their word for it over anything. I'm good.
And I guess
just think she's annoying on camera because she wants to turn up and she's annoying and goes into like.
Okay.
The Nora show. What I'm saying is they probably do know each other on some level. And like the fact that they fought is. I get what you're saying where, like, I think at worst it's indifferent. At best they were fighting for this scenario.
All right.
Because they fought, they have some sort of connection that they obviously both felt. And when I re-said the thing when Norris was like, wait, did you really mean that? Or are you mimicking me? And Jasmine thought about it for a second. Like, I think that they did have some genuine, like, okay, I kind of fuck with this girl. Like, I would kind of fuck with this girl.
All right, maybe.
They're in a house of 16 people. They're on, like, a retreat, essentially.
And I guess here's another thing is they haven't, have we seen this before where we know someone's a perfect match and the cast knows that someone's a perfect match? While they still have 2 weeks left in the house.
No, we have not seen
3 weeks left in the house.
No, absolutely not. This was so groundbreaking, amazing
I guess I would be more shocked.
I want to talk about that. Go on.
It definitely shocks me, and it still will make me scratch my head. But it's not like, it would shock me if on a different season, let me be very clear. We haven't seen this before, but they know it in the house. I'm thinking it more of like, if someone went to the honeymoon suite and welcome back, blah, 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 who we know didn't really care about each other. Something like that. We've had that in previous seasons. Uh-huh. Two people go to the honeymoon suite who we know didn't really care about each other.
Yes.
Weird for that random couple to go to the honeymoon suite and then they come back and they're like, yeah, actually, like, we love each other. Kiss each other. And like, it would be so weird for that to happen.
That is what we all want to happen, though, right? At least for me, that's what I'm hoping every time.
Sure, because it's wild and it is strange.
And that's what the producers want.
Oh, I'm sure,
listen,
yeah.
We found their perfect match. You get them alone in a honeymoon suite.
Anything can happen.
I want to see a season where, at the end, there's like 7 people in the house. Just kidding, that couldn't happen, but...
They win in, like, week 3.
I mean, how many people could be in the honeymoon suite? I want to see, like, 6 people struggling for weeks, and the other 6 people living it up in the honeymoon suite where we get more footage from the honeymoon suite because it's an awesome time.
It's
just people in love. Like, this is what we worked through, and it was cool. Like, you know what I mean? That is the goal. But what I wanted to say about... I already said it. I just said it because you led me to it. I didn't even know that's what I wanted to say, but that was pretty much it.
Anyways, I feel like we've exhausted this topic.
Yep.
I don't have much else to say.
One thing I want to say is when watching this show, if you're scratching your head and not being able to wrap your mind around something, and same to me as well, like that's the moment for like a Buddha laugh, like, I'm learning something, right? Like, this is the moment for me to just be like, huh, I'm a straight white person. Not that race matters in this situation, but like, I'm a straight person scratching my head at these. Oh, that's what this is about. Like, it's, they know, I don't.
I agree with you, but there was a moment where I was scratching my head this episode that I don't think was a Buddha moment, where I don't think I could have become more enlightened. And okay. It was when Jasmine and Nora walked up and Terrence acted as if he had not seen any of the footage of them confirming they were a perfect match.
Whoa, what's this? Wow,
look at you two. This is quite the difference.
I mean, is it a head scratch or an eye roll?
Both at the same time.
I just think, either way, going back to what you said about how we've never seen the house know that there's a perfect match and everyone else know, or but they're not confirmed, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
That moment in the house where they're all figuring out, and Danny's like, well, that means...
You're a confirmed perfect match.
You guys are a perfect match. And everybody cheered. It was awesome. That was amazing.
Yeah.
And remember when I rewound it to that one shot of Danny after they got through all of it? They're like, all right, this is enough work for tonight. They got Basit and Jonathan confirmed. Nora and Jasmine confirmed.
Uh-huh.
And then they realize it's either Danny and Kai or Mustin.
Yeah.
So that's the cliffhanger matchup, which is where we can leave this episode, at least.
Oh, yeah.
But when they realized they had done their due diligence and they got pretty much four matches out of it, including Aisha and Brandon, Danny is just like, his glasses are hanging off his face. He's tucking in the back of his shirt.
You know
what
I just realized?
He looks lost.
He looks like that meme of the woman on the sidewalk.
Yeah. With like Cotton Eye Joe. When the DJ just played whatever, the Cha-Cha Cupid Slide, Shuffle. And now plays Cotton Eye Joe. That meme.
That's what Danny was doing.
He was just talking in the back of his shirt like, but it was different because that meme is, I have to keep going. Danny was like,
this is the end.
Yep.
This is, okay, we're now this we is our to... last ride at Six Flags family, and we are getting in the car after
right.
this.
I have now finished, like, the map is done. We've done every ride we said we were going to do, and all right.
We figured out as many matches as we could possibly figure out.
Cutest fucking little gif.
Good for him and Kari, though. Just getting that organized.
They're a match.
Figuring it out.
I'm going to lock in Kari and Danny.
I don't even know if that's a possibility, but also
it's definitely not a possibility.
Props to them and props to the show, I think, maybe for not just like, and maybe they had no choice. Maybe the production had no choice but to show them figuring out these two matches. But I feel like in previous seasons, Devin with the cups, you know, the other seasons 1, 2, and 3 where they could actually use props and stuff. I mean, they must have known, all right, we have 6 confirmed matches and we have 2 scenarios. But they never really said it. They never showed them saying that. They never showed them, like, celebrating, hey, we figured one out.
Well, because you know what? And this is just me being judgmental of straight people, which I feel like I have a right to be. These people are actual people. They're interesting. They're not just there to like,
I don't think that would serve
their image. I'm just saying that as much as it's kind of clicky, it seems, it's not as clicky as other seasons. And so they all genuinely spend time together. And that was I don't think that happens in these other houses. Like,
I think in a different season, I don't think that matters at all.
I think in a different season, the amount of time you're willing to spend together when it's not mandatory, where you don't feel like this is very kind of a couple steps away from the normal line of thinking.
Okay.
I'm kind of assuming a lot, but I think I've watched enough of this show. In the house, I bet a lot of people, in previous seasons as opposed to this season have been way more concerned with looking cool to the camera, to the house, to editing, to everything. Absolutely. And so therefore, if it's not mandatory to be sitting there, it's almost uncomfortable for them to still be sitting there for fear of not looking cool.
What are you talking about?
Trying to figure this out. Sitting there and looking.
But they figured it out every season, besides one.
But not the whole group together reenacting every matchup.
They did. They've done that before. They did that last season. They did that last season. Remember? They were. I just remember the image of them sitting on that couch and they just.
Well, that was more mandatory. That probably seemed more mandatory.
This seemed mandatory to Kai. Kai did not want to be there. They were.
Kai's the only one.
Okay.
Do you not get what I'm saying? I don't think it's foolproof. I'm not saying that this is exactly what happened. I just think that there's some level of that where these people will spend all day together. We've gotten so much from them. This has been a learning experience for us. Yeah.
Sure, but I don't think that that applies to whether MTV decides to show certain stuff or doesn't. Mm. In terms of this.
100% not, but this season is so good that it doesn't matter. MTV cannot hide how much. They had so much to work with that whatever plot lines, we see little glimpses of, think about it. After Dr. Frankie, with the whole Kai situation, where three separate people bring up three separate issues that they're dealing with on their own that all led back to Kai. Do you remember that?
Mm-hmm.
After that, they're all sitting by the pool. And yes, having drinks, but like adults for once. And it becomes, Kai tries to talk shit, and Jenna's like, make sure you'd say it in front of them. And then the whole house is there because they all like each other and hang out together and don't feel...
The whole house was not there, but most of them were. I get what you're saying. There were like six people.
And everyone was willing to weigh in and willing to make it a moment like that wasn't... I just think I've never been on a reality show, but I just have a feeling that it's similar to filming a class project where like you have an idea that you map out, then you go there to film it and you're like, oh, I'm not going to be that goofy for goddamn sure. Like our class is going to see this. And then the whole thing goes to shit because you're like, you know what I mean? It's the same thing with the reality show. Like I'm a good time.
I agree with everything that you're saying.
You think, oh, the cameras are going to catch all of this. I'm going to only do things that are for the camera. I don't know. No, that just was organic. Okay.
I think this whole season has
been organic.
I agree with what you were saying. And just because we don't need to keep talking ourselves into knots here. I just think in a different season, seasons 1-7, they probably had moments like this of, sweet, we figured out you're a match. And then MTV decided not to show that part.
I disagree.
You don't think they had those moments? I mean, they had to have had those moments because they won and they went through all the scenarios and they used Coke bottles or cups or whatever the hell they used.
Oh,
I'm saying there were moments where they figured out matches.
I guess we have different definitions of the word moments.
Okay. I mean, I'm sure whatever there was a moment in time where each of the seasons they figured out matches before they sat together, whether that was the last episode or 2 weeks before the last episode, whatever. MTV decided not to reveal to us that they had sorted out a specific couple.
Well, I guess
this one they decided to show them figuring out that Nora and Jasmine were a match and that Basit and Jonathan were a match.
Okay, I hear
and I
you.
Wonder if that has anything. I'm just it intrigues me that they decided to do that.
I
think it may have something to do with the fact that everyone knows about the math blog now, and the people that watch this show are also always on social media and are also on Reddit and also, you know, just talk about that
stuff.
Not
during the show, though.
During the show?
Not while they're filming.
Sorry, not the people that are on the show. The people that watch the show.
Yeah. Okay.
The viewers.
I don't know how that pertains to how they act on the show and the fact that they got together and everyone in the house was there to react to the fact that they found all these couples.
Mm-hmm.
I understand what you're saying. I don't think that was a production decision. I'm saying to my point earlier that because of this cast, as opposed to other casts, I think other casts, 1 through 7, a couple people, they had a big group meeting like that, and then it dwindled off because people got bored and didn't feel like they were allowed to sit and watch and help because they weren't being useful or whatever. And they didn't want to be caught on camera doing something stupid because they weren't involved. Do you know what I'm saying by that? So I think that the way that they told people who to pick it once they figured out the matches, it was like brushing your teeth and Leighton's like, hey, I think you're this match. It's not a moment. This was a moment because they all sat there and figured it out together outside of, like, in the house. And they were all like, oh my God. Like, that's why it was so cool. As opposed to other times where they were like, it was like a late night study session. And they're like, okay, I think this is it. Hopefully we win. Sorry. We got it. Like, great. And then they, like, kind of told each other throughout, like, little, they weren't moments. Like, they couldn't have been moments. I don't think it was a decision. I think it was that.
Okay. All right. I at least understand what you're saying.
Thank you.
Yeah. I disagree. Okay. I mean.
Fair enough.
Yeah. I mean, I think this one may have had a more organic, more celebratory moment than other seasons. I still think it's interesting that they decided to reveal that the cast knew specific matches versus previous seasons, for they must have known matches at certain points. That's all. It just intrigues me. I don't really have a stance on it.
Oh, probably because, yeah, the math bug. They want people to be like, what do they think? We're idiots here? Yeah.
And I also wonder if, like, maybe, you know, this is week 8. This was matchup 8. And those moments probably didn't happen until matchup 9 or 10 in previous seasons, just because there are more couples and I don't know.
There's less options though, Reg.
I'm not sure.
Are there not less options?
There actually might not be less options.
Because there's so many more couples.
I forget what it is, but
they probably did the math before.
They made the decision to have dumber people on the other seasons, but I just wonder.
Well, I don't think they factored that in because they hired Frankie.
And it may have been impossible for Noor and Jasmine to show them these next 3 episodes without revealing. Like, they would literally have to cut them out of the whole show, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
Same thing with Bissett and Jonathan. So I don't know.
Interesting stuff.
There's a lot to think about.
Something to.
It's all like stupid ass, like, shit that I find interesting.
No, I think it's interesting too. Production choices. Yeah.
And
I do. I respectfully am going to go
with
my thing of the fact that, like, they were passing it through tired mouths, and when they figured it out, it was like the last ones left who were still going to try and win this, and everyone else was like, I'm picking what I like.
And then
they were like, no, we figured it out. And then they were like, I'm going to trust it. Like, I don't think there were moments. I think this was the first cast because that's TV. That was the best thing ever to watch, was all of them cheering on their own in that room, like half in the kitchen, half in the living room.
I do think maybe it's just a choice of, like, where do we center the suspense? And previous seasons, they had, you know, Alexis or Keith burning Alexis's doll and, like, shit like that. Like,
she's about to start talking.
Oh my gosh.
Oh no, she's not.
But like kind of ridiculous things happen.
Yeah.
And maybe that's where they centered the suspense and the drama.
I'm glad they did that. That's a choice.
Oh, for sure.
Pro Bridget.
For sure. And maybe they centered the suspense on those seasons. Maybe they're just done. Okay. We don't want to center the suspense just solely on, did they figure it out? We're not going to let you know any insight of how close they were. And this season, all right, they're getting close. Let's at least show the process. Yeah. Okay, season 8, let's switch it up. And we're already switching it up big time. Let's actually show them figure it out. That's what people actually care about sometimes.
Yeah. I'm still going to give the credit to the cast and say that the fact that they're so willing to talk to each other, that we get footage that you cannot production cannot coax out of anyone else. I'm just going to go with that. I just can't.
Also, for what it's worth, and we were talking about it earlier.
Every episode I take away, like, these people are fucking amazing and should always be on TV in some form or fashion.
Can I kind of jump into Let's Get Social? We had three people.
Yes, because you had a great segue that then you mulled over because you... I just said mulled over too many times. But you said suspense. We have a suspense in the matchup, which is great. Now, let's get social.
Social. This might even... this girl, Honor, H-O-N-O-U-R.
Honor?
She DM'd us. So this might be like... breach of Let's Get Social, but I found it was an interesting point that I wish would have happened, and that's why I'm saying it right now.
Is it honor? British? Like favor? It could
be. I don't know.
Like favor, but honor?
That's how it's spelled.
Okay.
Yeah. But she said she was talking about her theory as to why they revealed the Bassett and Jonathan matchup.
Okay.
Was that Jonathan was going to mess it up. And we'd be able to watch, knowing that they were a perfect match, we'd watch him kind of crash and burn. And that was going to be, like, the drama surrounding that. And I kind of, like, obviously, I don't...
What does that mean?
She said that, like, that was her theory as to why. Because remember last week we were speculating on why they showed the Bassett and Jonathan, like,
but did they,
why they revealed that.
But they didn't tell Bassett and Jonathan.
No, I know. And
so she's speculating.
She's speculating. This was...
We don't know. They are speculating that.
This was last week. She sent this to us.
Okay. But I'm asking you something.
Yeah.
Are they under the impression that Bassett and Jonathan were also informed that they were a perfect match?
No.
Okay. So how is us knowing preventing him from crashing and burning?
Us... not at all.
Okay, so what's the point? No offense to Honor.
The point is that they wanted to let us in on knowing that they were a perfect match.
Because
knowing that they had this footage of Jonathan then fucking it all up, and it would be more enjoyable from the viewer's standpoint to know, holy shit, they're a perfect match and he's totally ruining it. Obviously that's not what happened. It doesn't seem like that's what's going to happen. You're not getting this. It makes sense in my head, and maybe I'm explaining it poorly.
I'm not getting it.
But, whatever.
I'm so... There's a chronology misunderstanding here. I'm not sure where it is. Is it when she sent that tweet?
She sent it to us last week.
So we didn't... They weren't... No, Jonathan had turned a corner last week. So, unless maybe they're proposing that there was a bunch of footage of Jonathan fucking it up that went unseen.
No. I don't think that's what...
Okay. Well, then, I'm so sorry, but it doesn't make sense because...
It makes sense to me.
How? Okay, you don't want to explain it again? I'm willing to try and understand.
No one else wants to listen to me explain
it. Why?
So this person is saying that the reason that they revealed to us that Jonathan and Bassett were a perfect match 2 weeks ago,
mm-hmm.
the reason they did that was because they knew they had all this footage. They knew that the way the season played out, what actually happened was from that moment where they kissed, Jonathan continued to like mess it up. And eventually they ended up like not together, but they were a perfect match. And the production decided that, and all of this is nonsense because none of it ended up happening, but production ended up deciding to reveal that to us because they figured, oh, the viewers will like to know that they're a perfect match.
Okay.
So that they can kind of be in on the joke or in on the drama of like, holy shit, they're a perfect match and Jonathan's ruining this.
Okay. I get what you're saying.
If that makes sense.
And what I was missing was that Honor did not see Bassett and Jonathan stroking palms while just having that conversation.
Well, and then...
So that, like, that was when Jonathan would have fucked it up. After the reveal. But he didn't. But production knew that because they edited it. And that was filmed before. I'm still a little lost.
Production knew... Whatever. I don't want to...
I think that...
A millionth time.
I think that if...
It's interesting.
If you're listening, when we listen back, it will be more clear.
Okay.
So you guys know more than we do right now. Something that's never happened on the pod before.
Oh my God. No more than what? All right.
Because we don't know what we're talking about anymore or where we're at. Mind.
Okay. Last two tweets.
Okay.
Buzz Your Girlfriend said they should have Bassett do a commentary on every season going forward. I'm in tears laughing at them every episode. I mean, goes without saying.
Yes.
And we've said it a bunch.
It's
got to get the Bassett show.
Mm-hmm.
And then Danielle pointed out to us before this episode, because last week we were speculating, okay, we have the VMAs coming up. We thought they were going to win last night, two nights ago. Thought they were going to win because of the schedule and everything. And then MTV... like Monday morning or like last Thursday said there were three episodes left.
Still basically was reply to us. Might as well have been in our DMs.
It was still kind of vague though, because it was like the cast only has three episodes left to figure it out. Like three more chances. So they still could get it done in one chance. So I wasn't quite sold on it, but
mm-hmm.
obviously there's two more weeks.
But I mean, this is a cliffhanger. Definitely. And they're dragging it out. I'm still going to say, if they win this matchup coming up, we were right. At this point, okay. I wouldn't be surprised sure. if yeah.
they just drag it out
dragged anymore. It out. And then we're like, oh, Labor Day weekend, we're taking a Monday off.
Certainly could be, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So.
I just want to say this last thought. Oh, Fashion Corner really quick.
Okay.
And then last thought. And then winner, loser?
No. I'm so tired.
You can't think of one off the top of your head right now.
Wait.
Hold it. Jasmine and Nora, there's one fashion corner. That's it. And I'm sure there were way more, but Jasmine and Nora, before they knew they were perfect matches, had the perfect, like, negative photo versions of each other's Gwen Stefani zip-up short sleeve hoodie, black and yellow. It was amazing. And that was all.
That was the only fashion corner?
That was the only fashion corner, even though there was probably so much more. My final thought is that I want them to do another bye season. I fear that they won't and that this is like a one-off, but this was... so interesting. For math purposes, it adds an element. There's no reason not to. This doesn't need to be some sort of like one-off. It should be the format. This is where they should go.
I fear that this is the
final, are you the one season yes. in general? Same. Yeah. Same.
Here it's the finale.
I mean, ended on a high note. Going back to the George Costanza. I mean, going back to the Seinfeld joke. Leave the room on a high note. Remember that episode where George is... someone says, like, you gotta, like, end on a high note, whatever. And it escalates to the point where he's, like, in a business meeting and makes a joke. Everybody laughs and he just walks out of the room. It's, like, inappropriate. That's
leaving on a high note.
That's what they're doing. It's inappropriate. You should keep going. We don't need another 24 hours of ridiculousness. Just make another show that a couple people watch.
But we need it. I love my ridiculousness Sundays. I watch it from midnight to midnight.
Give me more Rob, dear Dick. Seriously, gross. That show, not necessarily Rob Dyrdek. Sorry. Rude. That's all we got. Winner of the week.
My winner was Miss Jello.
Mine was Miss Hello. Just kidding. Mine was the persona that Max takes on. My winner is Max's core, which is who is
so upset?
A worrying Italian grandmother, just having thousands of children and grandchildren to worry about, and just spends their days worrying. It was adorable. He's just like, you just don't get it. And Justin is just stroking him, like not even saying real things that are comforting.
Yeah.
You know, we're all going to match up. And then you found what you were looking for. You found your perfect match. And Max is like, you just don't get it. We actually should do a reenactment of that.
That is so fucking funny.
Not tonight.
Just seeing Max.
That is my winner, is Mustin. He gets
so mad about that. And just, yeah, everything. It's my so out tied. Of his so out of his control. And he's so upset.
Mm-hmm.
It's so good. Just so much anxiety.
Babushka.
Freaking the fuck out.
Okay, go ahead.
What?
Who's your winner?
Oh, Miss Jello.
I mean loser, I'm sorry.
Oh, my loser is...
1, 2, 3, Kai.
1, 2, 3, I don't know. Girl, I didn't really have a loser.
Again, this is the second week in a row we're going to end it on. Grow up, Kai. Good night.
Grow up.
I was walking through icy streams that took my breath away.